Hello, you're listening to Hibs Talk. I'm your host, Stuart, for this evening. And because Gav is on holiday and he's lying on his sofa eating Empire biscuits, which he usually brings into the show. Tonight, we've got Dave.
All right.
Right, and we've got Stuart.
All right.
Right, so this is going to be difficult tonight because we've got two Stuarts, me, Stuart. So we're going to call me Papa Stuart because I'm the old one. I'm the old one out of the lot of us here.
I think I'm catching you up, to be fair.
Are you? Well, I don't know, are you? What age are you now, Stuart?
I'm 35.
Oh, Christ.
Compared to the other whippersnappers on this.
I know. Aye, well, you've got 20 years, mate, to catch up. Aye. Right, so tonight we're going to be talking about the game against St Johnstone, of course. Also, we have enough cover up front since Nisbet's got injured. And chat about the defence. I'd like to have a wee chat about that. And talk about our next game, the Aberdeen. And also, a breaking news about wee Boyle. Going right into it, the game against St Johnstone. Now, I think we'll go to you, Stuart, and we'll ask, what do you think about the game against St Johnstone?
Oh, I thought it was a fantastic bit of football. Bayern Munich would have been proud of that. You know what? It's not always going to be pretty. I think that's fair to say. How many times have we seen Hibs playing so well, looking the business, and then walking away from absolutely nothing from it? It wasn't quite snatching victory from the jaws of defeat, but I don't think anyone's going to be able to sit there and kind of remind themselves of the time that we won 1-0 at McDermott Park. But we've got an unbelievable record against St Johnstone. I think before that game kicked off, I read somewhere the last 21 games was 7 wins to Hibs, 7 wins to St Johnstone, and 7 draws. So there's really not a lot to decipher between any of us there.
Yeah, correct. Now, Dave, what do you think? Now, we were watching it in my bar on Sunday, bar 24, and it's been bringing us good luck because we keep on actually seeing the results coming in. So what do you think about the game?
That wasn't a classic. It's not going to be repeated on Sky during the next pandemic anyway. I'll be watching that one again. But just decent result in it. But to be fair, mate, I was half pissed. I can't remember half the game.
I know, that's why we're asking Stuart. I'm glad you came in, Stuart. Well, the things that we can remember, we were actually quite lucky with regards to the goal that St Johnstone got chopped off, because it was, what, at least a yard, I would imagine, Dave, that he was offside.
Aye, no, definitely lucky. Like, but I can't really remember the last time we had luck like that. It always seems to go against us, so complain. But Marciano had a bit of a nightmare there. He got away with it.
There is an online debate going on that he saw the flag, so he came out half-hearted. How accurate that is, not sure.
Well, it's actually funny how you thought, you know, you're saying that, Stuart, because when I seen the rerun the next game day, I had a look at that, and he did come out half-heartedly, and he's like halfway through there, and he just put his hand up as if he seen something, like, you know, he was offside. But I think he got away with it.
Maybe
definitely
had,
got him that Hibs did.
Maybe had flashbacks to last season. Mind last season he came fleeing out and got sent off it up there.
That's true.
That's right.
Probably thought, shit, I can't come, because it was the same end and everything. So he's probably like, nah, I'll just throw myself at this a wee bit.
Well, there you go. There's a lot differently, isn't it? There's a lot turned.
But look at the St Johnstone players when that ball went in. None of them were celebrating. None of them were convinced that it was onside themselves. Does that sell it a bit as well?
Aye, well, I think when it shows you it a couple of frames later, like, it is quite offside. I think it was Horgan that was playing him on, if I can remember rightly. And then, was it Horgan?
I think you're right.
Who cares? Somebody in a green tap, anyway.
Well, listen, guys, we got a rub of the green there, but on the other hand, we didn't get a rub of the green because, in my opinion, it's only mine, Doige's goal, God knows what was wrong with that. Now, there again, guys, you know, what's your thoughts?
bit of a flashback to the old playoff game versus Falkirk. Does the ball for it there? I could see why it was getting chopped off. If it had been scored against us and given, we wouldn't have been happy. But it goes back to what Dave was saying about luck. Sometimes it's not going for you. I think it was the right decision in the end. Maybe green tinted specs, you could have got away with that one. Bodies on the ground, hits off somebody. He's quickest to react. No impediment on the keeper. But that was the decision.
If you hadn't seen it like a million times already, like down south, like any touch of the hand for a striker, then it's a handball. Like who was it? There was an Arsenal game, I think, and the boy actually fell out of the ball. And it like touches his hand ever so slightly. And it wasn't even in, if it didn't even feel like it was in the same phase of play. And it all got pulled back for because of that one moment. So I've definitely seen harsher ones. So that probably makes it feel a wee bit more understandable. If that had just happened to us, and I hadn't seen all that beforehand, I would be like, nah.
Right, well, okay, right. Let's say that it could be like a 1-1 with regards the decisions. A bit of nothing gained. So we can fast forward to about the 90th minute. And, of course, Rod, your thoughts? Definitely penalty, in my opinion.
Oh, clumsy. I'm telling you, if you see that at a kid's level, yeah, I'm not going to say you're going to be shouting at a kid, but you're going to explain to them why you're crashing through the back of two attacking players when you've got no chance of getting the ball. That's what it comes down to.
Dave, was it a penalty on Porteous or was it a penalty on Hanlon?
See, if I'm honest, I think it's quite a harsh penalty. And then you're going to disagree with me. But I didn't really see. I think we're a wee bit fortunate that it got gained. It could have easily just been missed because they were both kind of at it. Like, I've watched it that many times and I'm still not convinced what actually happens. Like, who gets shoved? Like, just kind of
Dave, I thought it was actually on Porteous because yeah. I don't know who the defender was, when the defender hit him, he went down and he went into Hanlon and brought Hanlon down as well. So I thought it was on Porteous, but, you know, anyway, we got it. You know, we got the decision.
You've got to look at these things, and it's something I've discussed with mates doing the pub down here so many times, that if that happens anywhere else on the park, something that stupid or clumsy, it's a free kick. How's that not a penalty?
Yeah, correct. So we got it. And now, this is a question. If you were in Mallan's shoes, who you have not been kicking a ball for the team, you come on, I think you had half an hour he played, came on for Scotty Allen. Now, would you be up to hit that ball in the last seconds?
You've put it down to great management. Obviously, had belief in the player coming off the bench. First time he's played in a long time. And you know what? He's got the strength to kick it. We all know what he can do from distance. Even if the keeper goes the right way, his hand's no stopping that.
No, but the way he hits a ball, like it's probably that is his strength, isn't it? He's definitely weaker at other parts of the game, but the way he strikes a ball is what he's all about. So, and he's the type of player that will see when he's at training and that he'll just want to just hit shots and that all the time. So in the last few months, that's what he'll be doing.
Well, I was actually going to talk about him later in the program, but anyway, we'll come back to him. So a great 3 points, guys. Got out of jail, done the bus, done the road in the bus, happy. Everybody happy, yeah?
No, it's decent, but I am a wee bit concerned about the last three games that we have played, I'll just be honest. I'll take the results, I'll take being tap, and this is probably like why Herb's fans never happy or why am I never happy, but I just think if this is how we're going to play our season, we won't get that lucky again in a game where we get a penalty like that in the 90th minute and then a goal that should have been in disallowed. I just think I'm a wee bit concerned. And but the only good thing is Jack Ross did say that we played bad. So the fact that he can see it, I'd be concerned if he didn't see it and he came out like, I don't know, you see Aberdeen playing bad every week and then Derek McInnes coming out and saying it was a good performance. I'd be worried if we had that. But the fact we don't and he said we're going to strengthen, then aye.
Absolutely. But I also want to combat that with, I'll be the glass half full one, Dave, if you didn't mind. We've played three teams that are just going to clog up the play. Dundee United, St Johnstone, Motherwell have all just kind of come to niggle at us. Not kind of hacking and fouling, but it was a very kind of Aberdeen-type performance from them. How are you meant to play football against that?
Yeah, no, I get that. But then at the same time, we've played bad the first halves. And it seems to be that we're not changing that we were playing in the first half, and then we'll wait until midway through the second half and then we tweak it. And it's like teams have maybe got us sussed a wee bit to how to play, whereas when we set up the way we're setting up at the start of the game.
Yeah, well, it isn't nice to watch the last couple of games. However, you know, I've said that at the start of the programme here that I'm older and I've seen a lot of bad teams at Easter Road, especially in the 80s when we were going through a change, and we never got anywhere. It was horrible to watch and we never got the points. So getting the points, we were jumping up and down, Dave.
We won, so, and we're happy league. And then see,
of course,
see if we play shit all season and win the league, I'm not going to moan. So
no, oh, that's good. That'll be one then.
Yeah, right. I'm going to be hypocritical there. So
we've spoke about the St Johnstone game. In what you've said, we've never played well for the last few games. But that's always, they always say a good team always churns out, you know, the points, and we've done it. Now we've played five games. We've got 13 points, and if we had been asked that at the start of the season, we would have bit everybody's arm off. So we've got to say, right, we've got it, we've got 13 points, and we're at the top of the league. So apart from goal difference.
And how many times have you seen us with our, no offence to the teams we played, a relatively straightforward start to the season, as in we've not played Aberdeen, obviously we've not got a derby, we've not played the Old Firm, and we've taken our advantages. We do have that points total.
Man, I completely agree. I want to see a wee bit more entertainment in my football, if I'm being honest, but that's just me.
I think we all do, Dave, but at this moment in time, if we can entertain near the end of the season when we've got the points and we're safe and we're in a good position. But at the time, I'm happy, and I think most of us are. We've got 13 and, you know, points. So drop two, I'm, you know, over the moon with that. So that was a game against St Johnstone. Now, we thing that I'm concerned about is up front. And I did say this a few weeks ago to you, is do we need cover for a centre forward position? Because there's Nisbet injured, and is Jamie Gullen good enough to step up and play if Doidge gets injured as well? So I'll ask you, Dave, on this one.
See the way you said step up and play there. Just put Penny Arcade in my head. You should never say that sentence ever again. Right, you need to rephrase that. Is it good enough? Well, I would expect him to be good enough, otherwise what was the point of bringing him back for his loan? Surely you would have kept him out to develop, and maybe he might go out on loan if we bring more bodies in, but I think...
But sadly, there's just that big difference between can we bring him on with 20 to go, like we did against St Johnstone there, or are we starting with him up top?
He used to get a chance, so didn't he? When he looked good.
I'm concerned, forget about Jamie Gullen at this moment, I'm concerned that we've got two main strikers, that one is injured and he's got a hamstring, so we don't know, 3-4 weeks, 5 weeks, or is it just precautionary? They've never came out and told us yet. However, if it is 3-4 weeks, or do we revert back to play, you know, 4-5-1, one up top, or do we put Boyle up there? What do we do? Do we actually have to change it, or do we play the young boy? That's what my concern is. Do we not need another centre forward brought in?
Yes, absolutely. We definitely need one. I think we were on the chat group today, and I think we figured out that we were looking about kind of 4 or 5 years ago since we had enough cover up top. Now, whether that answer is Stuart up at Ross County, or Simon Murray, there's pictures of him doing the rounds right now, or someone completely different, we need a first team striker to come in.
Yeah, definitely.
Lee Griffiths.
Yeah. Lee.
I would take him tomorrow, but Lennon, I don't know what it is. Lennon's not wanting to play him, but he's not wanting to let him go. So,
and they keep signing strikers as well.
I know. He's about fifth down, but he says he's injured. So apart from him,
see, if I was Big Ron, I'd take all the backlash for the McCrory thing, because he made an absolute arse of that. And I would be like, Ken Witt, I'm going to put this right, and I'd go and I'd sign Griffiths. So I would do.
Yeah.
So if I was a big ballsy guy with money, that's what I would do to make everybody happy.
You know what? I could seriously see Griffiths going to America.
Yeah.
Yeah. We get him out of that.
How would he do with all his wins?
Aye. That's the thing. He's not going to see them. But, you know, he would be my first pick. But I still reckon that we need another player coming in. And that's not to put Jamie Gillen down the pecking order. It's just to have another centre forward, because we've got one injured, one is going to be playing every game, and if something happens to him, we've got young boy. That's it. So, you know,
more than happy to see Jamie Gillen playing the League Cup games that we've got coming up. That's going to be great for him to get out there. But him up top against Aberdeen, and yeah, then we've got the Old Firm back to back. That's not brilliant.
Now, I want to bring this up because you don't see a lot about defence being mentioned. I think we've not gave enough praise to our centre backs and our right and left back, because that's, well, the last 3 games I've not let a goal in, and we've not let a goal in an open play. And I said this last time, so touch wood that, yeah, I'm not, you know, going to do it, and we're going to play Aberdeen and lose. But what I'm saying is, they guys are playing fantastically now. They're against St Johnstone, we were under the cosh, and I think that they played absolutely brilliant. Hanlon, man in the match. Porteous, possible man in the match as well. So, what do you think, guys? What's happened? What's the difference? Because we've only got 2 players of difference. You're right and left back. What's happened here?
I think there's a number of factors, to be honest. We've got guys like McGinn who are doing a simple job well. It's not going to be flashy, but they know exactly where they're on the park. Porteous, maybe a little bit more management there. He's calmed down a little bit, but he's learning his trade through the fantastic and experienced Paul Hanlon. Young laddie coming through, and Doig, brilliant confidence he's got. And a fair argument to say we've finally replaced Marvin Bartley. We've got someone to take away that pressure. At no point in the 5 games that we've watched so far this year can I think, oh, we're under the cosh. Oh my God, what are they doing here now? You've not got the usual kind of Hibs defensive sweats that you always get.
Yeah. Dave, do you think that Gogic is the difference within our defence, even though he's not playing defender?
Aye, well, it probably gave them that bit of security, and it probably helps that Hanlon's playing as well as he is as well. But I wonder if Hanlon feels like he's maybe concentrating a bit more because he has got a couple of young laddies next to him. So, whereas maybe he was, I don't know, it's maybe speculating, but if he's got McGregor not next to him, he wasn't taking charge. So maybe that's how Hanlon's playing better. He stepped up.
Yeah. Do you think that maybe it was, you know, I read this and I don't know how true it was, but he was carrying an injury.
Well, he was on this podcast, when he was doing his testimonial stuff and that, and he was groaning about his injury, and it sounded like a really weird injury, like bone groaning, like bone, like it was mental.
So maybe he was carrying an injury, playing every week, And the COVID getting a break has possibly helped him on. And
we said this last week, definitely, or 2 weeks ago. Definitely helped. So we just looked more solid. But I agree with Stuart. Paul McGinn, just simple. Everyone's. I like that. Like, just a defender that just defends. Like, I'm all right with that. And then let your flair players be day stuff.
See, there's a thing that you've said and what Stuart's saying about McGinn. David Gray used to battle on up the top, and you know, he used to box to box, and he would get found out coming back. And that's maybe where we were possibly losing out at the back, was because one of our centre backs was having to go to right back and cover for him. Could have been that, you know, we don't know. And McGinn's sitting there and just no bombing forward and sitting there and doing his job, as Stuart says. So do you think that we've got the defence right just now, and are you happy with him?
Oh, it's hard to put an argument against them, to be fair. As you correctly said, no goals conceded from open play, and the two we have conceded, one was the penalty against Livingston, which we're not quite sure what it was about, and the other one was just a brilliantly struck free kick from Burke, and again, didn't really look like much of a free kick.
We're happy with defence. Now, the gaffer spoke to Stevie Mallan half an hour ago. He told him, in his words, he says, go on and win the game. So he did, but probably not through a penalty, he would have thought. But Stevie Mallan, question is, as we were speaking about him earlier, came on, played well. What do you think that, is he due to be played, or will he have to wait on his game? You know, because you kind of just take out Scotty Allen. He played okay. Not, you know, it wasn't that fantastic. However, do you think that Stevie Mallan is still got to sit on the bench and wait, Dave?
Because I think he's going to be rotation for Allen, and I did think that at the start of the season. I thought that was always going to be your sub. One will play 60, then the other one will come on. But I still think there's an opportunity for him to play, like, as on the left, if we are playing a wee bit more narrow, because that's where he played with St Mirren, and he was quality in shooting, ball in the box.
Absolutely.
So I think that opportunity is there, and then that's how he got his move when he was at St Mirren, off the back of that to Barnsley. So,
do you think he's got the pace to be playing sort of cover at left back as well, Stuart?
I think pace is part of his game that we know isn't his strongest. But again, if we've got a kind of a situated defence and a defensive midfield type player to help support that, I don't see why not.
Yeah, I was going to say, you just have Gogic probably dropping in a wee bit. Say, Doig overlaps and Mallan. I wouldn't expect Mallan to be the one covering back across. I'd expect, like, Hanlon to shift left, Gogic to drop centre, and Porteous. That's what I would expect.
Because if we were to do that, if it did happen, we were playing at this moment in time, Horgan and Boyle out in the wing. So that's the first thing that the gaffer's doing well, is he's playing wingers as in a wing, you know, where they should be. So he's got Horgan playing, or, you know, the two of them are swapping left and right. So they are actually doing the defending as well, because they've got the pace. So, you know, who do you drop? It wouldn't be Boyle. So are you going to drop Horgan to put Mallan in there?
Drop Horgan? Yeah. I don't know. He shows in flashes that he's good, and then he can go a couple of games. He doesn't do enough for me.
You could say the same about Boyle so far.
Yeah, you could.
Well,
but I think over the...
I know we're going to talk about it later, so sorry, I'm not going to...
Over the course of careers, though, Boyle has longer hot patches than Horgan does. I feel like Horgan will maybe have a good game, and then he's anonymous, to be honest. Yeah. I think he's a position that we could probably do better.
Now, the game coming up, big game. Hibs-Aberdeen. This is a big one, because they're going to be coming on the back of two wins as well, two back-to-back wins. So their dander will be up now. So what do you think? Predictions on Sunday. I'm going to say Saturday, right? On Sunday, what do you think that we have to, how we have to play against them? Because they have got their strengths.
I think it's fair to say it's our first big test other than that pitch at Livingston. But you know what? However much it doesn't matter or matters right now, we're the home team. We should be able to control them. We know what Aberdeen are going to come and do. They're going to come and foul and foul and foul and try and hit us on the break with it. It's what they do every time. McInnes' tactics don't change. We beat them last season 3-0, and it's probably one of the highlights of the season last year. I don't see why we can't do the same again to them.
Yeah, well, I agree with that. And Dave, any changes that you think?
I would actually start Dre Wright because I thought he looked pretty decent when he came on. And last season, that 3-0 game that Stuart's talking about, that Boyle played really well in that game, and we seem to keep catching Aberdeen like in behind. So if you've got Wright and Boyle like playing right and left, then that, I think that would probably work.
So you would really want to kind of go the 3-5-2,
yeah,
have Boyle up top because we're not sure what's happening with Nisbet. That'd be brilliant, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right, so, right, well, what's, if that's the thing, it's quite simple. We're just moving one player and changing it to a 3-5-2. Your predictions, Dave, what's the score going to be?
I'm going to say 2-0 Hibs.
Stuart?
I was going to say the same thing.
So was I. I've got 2-0 written down here. You're
allowed to agree with me. I hope you agree with me every week. So it's fine.
Right, so 2-0, sure.
You know Gav's going to shout at us when he does the little kind of graphic for it, though.
Aye.
Because it's a really boring graphic, eh?
Yeah.
Well,
I'll say 3-1. There you go.
3-1. 3-1. Right, okay. 3-1.
We'll lose a goal from open play. There it is.
Well, there you go. I'm sticking with 2-0 because I still think that what I've seen from Aberdeen, I wasn't over-impressed. They got a lucky goal against St Johnston. They were very poor. And no, as you said at Easter Road, Dave, I think that, or Stu, you said it, we can get in behind them. We can control it. So I think we can beat Aberdeen. I think it's the time to get them. So I'm going for a 2-0. Dave, 2-0. And you're 3-1, Stuart.
Yeah, from a buddy who paid 13 quid to watch Red TV on Sunday, Aberdeen versus Livingston. I believe they weren't brilliant there either.
Yeah, well, I was listening to it. Well, we tried to before the Hibs game. Right, now, today, we're all either at work or could be a wee question in the future. Where were you when this happened? It came through about 4? Back at 4 o'clock? Boyle has signed a new deal till 2023. So, breaking news, fantastic, absolutely cracking. What's your thoughts, Dave? Are you happy?
Oh, I heard them in. And the announcement video was class as well.
Yeah.
The media team have really upped their game since that season ticket video.
I loved the Wolf of Wall Street.
It was class.
I loved that one. I'm not leaving.
Yeah. No. but to get him to sign another extension is just brilliant. And we might only have him another year or something, and it might go, but the 2 years that he'll have left when that does come round would add a bit of value to him as well. So it just works all round.
Yeah.
So I was really happy with it.
It does smack a bit of the deal we had with Cummins, but you know what? Let's enjoy him while we've got him. We know what he can do. He's a player that gets guys on their feet, whether you're in bar 24 or when we eventually get back to Easter Roads. Yeah, you know what? He's just what we want.
Yeah. Well, it's unbelievable how just before that, Messi is saying that he's coming out and leaving Barcelona, and he's number 10. And as you say, the media team did a fantastic job saying, "No, we've got our own number 10. You're not coming, Messi." So, brilliant. No, I'm over the moon because, and I called it, I don't know who says no, but I called it, was it yesterday when Rachel signed for the Hibs an extension and somebody says, ah, but you can still go to Celtic. And I thought, nah, they've been thinking, the two of them are happy, they've got the wee one. And as you say, if we can get a year out of them, you know, so be it. And then we'll get a fee. That's the main thing, we'll get a fee for them now.
There was an article in one of the Red Tops the day, and it was former Hearts striker Kyle saying that's it. He can, Rangers can come in and get him on the cheap when they sell Ryan Kent for 40 million to Leeds. Thanks very much, mate. Much appreciated. And I think what makes this even more surprising is, after one of the most unconvincing "are you staying or are you going" interviews I've ever seen with Martin Boyle, we'd pretty much all of us had written off, he's not signing a new deal. You know what, let's see what we can get. Can we start to do something with him to get somebody back in for us? Do we get Griffiths? Do we get a good young loanee from Celtic? But no, absolutely, as Dave said, over the moon with this one.
It's made a day, made a season up to now. Boyle's not been playing that great. However, he's maybe had this deal sitting over him. Possibly this will be him. He might just come out on Saturday. Maybe it's a good bet to put on for him to score a couple of goals or whatever, because he'll be thinking, right, I'm happy now. I've got my contract signed and I'm back to playing again.
Absolutely.
Yeah, you see it. I've heard... So I quite like listening to like Open Goal and all that, and in Cy Ferry will be talking about people when they go on trials or they've got scouts and that looking at them, and they play horrendously bad, like, because they've got people looking and watching them and that. So it maybe is in his head, like, shit, I've got like Huddersfield up there looking at me now. And then now the fact that he's decided he's staying, it's just gonna be fans that are wanting him to do well. So there's nobody, they might not play that. Yeah.
Well, that's it. So we've ended up in a high. We've got wee Boiler signed on until 2023. So everyone's happy. We've got 13 points out of 15. And hopefully we'll make it 16 on Sunday. And you've done your predictions, 3-1, 2-0, and I'm 2-0 as well. So, guys, great. Thank you very much for coming on the pod tonight. Now, what are you up to? What day is this? Is this Tuesday? Is it?
It's Wednesday, mate.
Is it Wednesday? Gosh. Oh, jeez. Right, it's Wednesday. Mind you, that's what it's because Monday was written off with Sunday. So, what he's got on till the end of the week, till Sunday, and where are you watching the game? Stuart, where are you watching the game about?
I'll be watching the game. Hopefully, this will be worth a free pint in the Goose Bar in Ramsgate, home of the Ramsgate Hib Supporters Club.
Oh, good man, good man. And have you got anything on till then? Anything exciting?
I think I'm meeting up with some family over in Canterbury on Saturday, so that should be quite nice.
Oh, that sounds very...
The wife's side of things.
Rather so good.
Yeah, something like that.
Did you have to speak proper when you spoke about Canterbury there?
Oh, you do. Nobody understands me down here, especially a couple of pints of watching the Hibs. The most exciting part of that Motherwell game was trying to point out to the barmaid, look, there I am, there's my cardboard cutout, and she just didn't care, honestly.
Ah, when she looked up, she seen the kangaroo.
Aye, that's
it. Oh, the value you've had out of your cardboard cutout is ridiculous. I've seen your cardboard cutout more times than I've seen my girlfriend in the last few hours. Ridiculous. I've never seen mine in the telly yet.
No, neither have I. Didn't even know where it is.
I do want to point out that Ian Crocker also retweeted my cardboard cutout this morning as well.
So, David, what are you up to? Are you doing it?
I am. Oh, it's my birthday tomorrow. Hey.
Oh, many happy returns.
Happy birthday, mate.
I'm 31, so I'm like nowhere near your age. So.
Oh, you look fucking
old. Fair enough, aye.
So... I'm actually working, but I'm playing my first game of fives after work, so throughout the Power League in Edinburgh, whatever it's called. So,
I'm dreading to ask, who are you watching the game on Sunday?
Well, I finished at 4 and the kick-off's 4:30, so I'll be at your bit and the pint will be poured and my seat will be saved. For 20 past four, I think I'll make it to yours.
You wake up at 20 past, same way. Yes, anybody who's not sure, they just tuned in for the first time. I built a bar over the summer. It's called Bar 24, and we've never missed a win at Hibs. We didn't see the Livingston game, but it's been good luck. We've won all the games, or never lost anyway. Sunday was pretty good, what we can remember. And we ended up watching the Bayern Munich game.
Didn't see much of that one either. But if you're inviting us up for the Rangers game at Easter Road on the, 13th now, on the Sunday.
Yeah, that's when it's
if we win there,
you
might
need
to build a new bar. Because... I've been dying to get Rangers for ages, man.
Aye, good.
Give me them.
For all you Hibs fans out there that are listening, all the best for Sunday. Hope we do it again. We'll speak to you next week. Thanks again for listening.
Gotcha.
Cheers. Thank you. Cheers, guys.